In this video, we will be building a reusable, extensible, and production-ready UI component similar to Shadcn UI. We're going to be working with Tailwind, class-variance-authority, and clsx. And also, by the way, this is exactly what I've done for all of the UI components in my upcoming React course, Project React. If you're interested, it's the first link in the description. So over here, I have a project that is created and running with Vite, and we're going to be creating a component inside of the components slash UI folder over here. This folder is meant to hold any React component that is pure UI, right? That means a simple component that usually doesn't have any state, doesn't do any complex logic, and only renders simple UI. For example, a button component or an input component. For this video, we're going to be building a button component that is very similar to Shadcn UI. In fact, it's actually going to be a simpler version of their button component. This will then allow you to build your own components just like this in your project, or if you want, you can go and use the ones from Shadcn UI and be able to easily edit and understand them after watching this video. You're going to find a link to this repository that is going to contain all of the code that I show in the video in the description. This is also going to have all of the dependencies with their correct versions, the ones that I used for this video. So first, let's start by creating a new file inside of components slash UI. So we'll come here, we'll right click new file, and we're going to do button.tsx. Then we can close this for now to make a little bit more space. And inside of here, we can create a new React component. So we can do rjsfc. This is a snippet that I have. If you're curious, I have a video on my VS Code setup that you can go and watch. This component is going to be called button like this. And for now, it's not going to return anything. Then we're going to come here at the top, make some space. And now we're going to start defining the props of this component because we are working in TypeScript. So I'm going to do type button props. And this will be a type. And here we actually want to give this button our own custom button component. We want to give it all of the props, all of the attributes that you could give to otherwise a normal HTML button element. And in React, to do this, we can use react.html attributes. And then here we can pass HTML button element like this. This is going to make these button props here be exactly everything as the HTML button element props that we could pass if we were to just use a normal button. So then we can come here to the button, we can do props, and then we can type these as button props just like this. And then we can come here and just return a button like this, and then pass the props over here. So what we're doing here is we're taking all of these props from this component, and we're just spreading them to the HTML button, which means that whatever we pass here when we're actually using the button component will also go to this HTML button. That's it. We're just using the normal HTML button, but we're wrapping it in our own custom button. And with this, we now have a fully working button custom component that we can use anywhere in our app. So that means we can come here, we can find our app.tsx file, we can open this, and we can replace all of this here, which has cause and solutions, which I put here as a reminder to say that, hey, did you know that over 50% of you watching this video are not subscribed? Which honestly is unfortunate because you're getting a ton of value here, and I really think that that deserves a subscribe button. So if you haven't subscribed, the button is right there and it's free. So now that we are subscribed, hopefully we can remove all of this and we can do button and then import our button from components UI slash button. And then we can call it like this and we can pass it some text inside. For example, we can do click me like this. If we now open up our browser, we can see our button here on the screen. If I can make it a little bit bigger so that you can see, this is our button. This works. Our cursor changes to a pointer when we hover over it, which is the default behavior of a button. This works exactly as we expect. Now, the next step for us to do is, of course, to add some styles because currently this button looks a little bit boring. Now, to add styles to this button component, we're going to be using the class variance authority library. This will allow us to configure different variants for our button, each with its own style. This will make our button reusable and have different styles easily based on a single prop. The first thing that we want to do is we want to come here to button props and we want to add another prop that is not part of these props here, the HTML attributes of a button. We want to add something that doesn't belong in there. What we're going to do is we're going to do variant like this, and this is going to be the different variants that our button can have. And we're free to configure this in any way that we want. For this video, we're going to keep things simple. We're just going to do two options. It's going to be primary, or it's going to be secondary, like this. So our button can only be of type primary, of variant primary, or a variant secondary. Then we're going to come here below the button component, and we're going to define something new. We're going to do const and then button variants. And that is going to be equal to a function, which we're going to do CVA, and that is going to come from class variance authority. This is a function that returns a function. So this button variant, it's highlighted here as a function. This function will return a string that we can use in the class name property of this button HTML element. This CVA function over here comes from class variance authority, and it essentially allows us to set some default styles for all of our buttons, regardless of their variance, and then apply some variance specific styles to our button. So if our button is a variant primary, we're going to apply some styles. If our button is a variant secondary, we're going to apply other styles, and we can override the default styles based on the variant that we pass as a prop. So first, let's start by adding the default styles. These are the styles that will apply to any button regardless of its variant. So I'm going to pass here as the first argument a string. These will be the default styles. And we're first going to add some padding to the button. So we're going to do padding Y of 2 and then padding X of 4. Then we're going to make this button a little bit rounded. So we can do rounded MD. Then we're going to want to add font semi-bold to make the text inside of the button a little bit thicker. And finally, we're going to add a hover state. So we're going to do hover. And then if the button is currently being hovered over, we're going to do opacity and then 50, just like this. This is simple enough, but it's going to get the job done for what we want in this video. Then, as the second argument to this function, we can pass our variant-specific styles. So we're going to pass here an object, and then we're going to do variants, like so, variants. And this is going to be all of the different variants that we can configure for this specific button, right? So this variant over here comes from CVA. You cannot define how this key is named over here, but this is going to be an object. And inside of here, you can do anything that you want. In our case, because we have a variant property here that can be either primary or secondary, we're going to put variant over here. So variant like this, and this is going to be an object as well. And now we're going to give both of our keys, primary and secondary. So we can do primary. That is going to be an empty string for now. And then secondary is going to also be an empty string like this. With this, we've now passed an object as our second argument to CVA. This object has the variance key, which comes from CVA. You cannot control this, but then we provided a variant property here, which we can use to determine if it's secondary, put these styles. If it's primary, put these styles. If it's secondary, put these styles. And this you're gonna see when we actually use this button variants over here, because this is a function and we're gonna be able to pass this variant prop from the props of this component to this function, and that is going to select the appropriate styles and merge them with these styles over here, and then style our button correctly based on the variant. So let's now start defining our styles. So we're going to come here, and in primary, we're going to do background gradient to right, so a gradient to the right from, and we're going to do primary 500. This is a color that I have set up in my Tailwind config. Then to primary 700. This is also another color that I set up in my config. And these are the basic styles of my traditional button of the color palette of Cause and Solutions. And then we're also going to do text black, because the text should be black on a background color like this. Then in secondary, we're going to keep things a little bit simple. We're just going to do background grayscale and then 700. And we're going to do text white, because in this case, the text should be white. Then the next thing that we want to do is actually add a default variant in case one isn't provided. Because the thing is, we don't want to have to provide this variant property every single time. Actually, we should make this optional, because if this isn't provided, we should just assume that the button is going to be of primary variant, because that's most likely what you're going to want in your project. So this makes sense. And then with this, we can come here, and at the same level as this top level variant over here, right below it, we can define default variants and pass this as an object. And then we can do variant like this. And this is now properly typed, as you can see here, because we have defined variant over here. That's where this is coming from. I can set for variant, I can do primary. It knows exactly the values that I have available, because again, they are coming from this object over here. We define variant, and then we define primary and secondary. So these are our valid options that we can use. And with this, now we can actually use this button variants over here in the class name prop of this button, because everything else is configured. So we can come here and we can do class name, name like this, and we can pass it here. We can do button variants. This is a function that we call. So we're going to call this function. And then we have to pass over here, we have to pass a variant, which can either be primary or secondary. So this, we're going to have to access it from the props of this component. So what we're going to do here is we're going to destructure this, and we're going to do variant like this. And then the rest of the props, we're just going to do dot, 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 props like this, because we don't want to destructure every single prop. We just want to group them in this props object here and still spread them exactly like we had it before. So then, now that we have this variant here, we can come here and pass it to button variant. We can do variant like this. And now the variant that we pass from the props of this component is going to get sent to the button variant, which is then going to configure the specific styles of that variant. Again, if it's primary, it's going to take these styles and it's going to merge them with these styles, and it's going to overwrite the styles that we have here. If it's secondary, it's only going to take the styles that we have here. That's how this works. And now, if we go back to our browser and open up the application, we can see that our button now has the updated styles. These are the primary styles of the primary variant. That's the gradient background that we configured here. And as you can see, in our app component, this is how the button is used. We haven't provided a variant, so it means that it's being defaulted to the primary variant, which actually means that we can come back here to app, and if we wanted to set this on a different variant for this specific page, all that we have to do is come here and do variant, and then we can do secondary like this, and now just with this, we have our button over here that completely changed its styles by a single prop. Now, the cool thing about this is that the button is still rounded. The button is still reducing opacity when we hover over it. Everything else that we configured to apply to all buttons is still being applied. The only thing that is different is the styles specifically to a variant that we've configured in this object over here, in this one here, in this primary and secondary object. Only the styles that we configured here are specific to a variant. Everything else applies regardless of the variant. And one thing to note, I did mention this, but it's worth re-mentioning. Here, we could have called this any way that we want. This could have been size, this could have been any other property, we could have passed this any other values. All that we would have to do is just configure those same values over here, and it would work exactly as we expect, exactly in the same way. We would just have to pass that property here and everything would work, right? So you're completely free to customize this in any way that you want. And oftentimes, if you're working in a real world project, you're going to have a design system that you have to adhere to, and you're just going to want to implement that design system in these props of this component, and it's going to work and it's going to be super, super efficient. Now, there's one more thing that we want to do here to improve this component a little bit better. We also want to make this component be extensible so that if this app component here wants to apply some custom styles that does not belong to any variant, that are perhaps just one-off styles for this one specific page or component, we want to allow this component, the app component, to configure that on the button and overwrite any specific styles that we set in this button variants object. And so the way that we're going to do that is we're also going to come here and we're going to access the class name property of the button props that again comes directly from these props over here. Every button element in React will have access to a class name that we can destructure over here. And then what we're going to want to do is we're going to also want to take into account this class name property along with the button variants and merge these two together and use the class name to overwrite anything in button variants. And the way that we're going to do that is actually super simple. We're going to have to create our own utility function that we're going to use to merge these two things together. So what I'm going to do, I'm going to come in here inside of the utils folder, and I'm going to create a new file, and I'm going to call this cn.ts. I'm going to close this, and here I'm going to define a function, export function, cn.ts, I mean, not .ts, the file is .ts, but the function is called cn. Cn is short for class name, that's why this is called it this way. This function is going to use two things. It's going to use the Tailwind merge function, TW merge from Tailwind merge, which is going to safely merge all of our classes here. Because in Tailwind, the order of the classes matter, and you want to be able to safely merge them, because if you don't, you might have some unexpected results and some styles that you think are being applied are actually not being applied because they're not implied in the order that you expect. The second thing that we're going to have to use is a thing called clsx. This is a library that allows you to pass multiple things and convert all of those to a string that ultimately results in the class name of a specific element. We're going to go over this as we're using these, so don't worry. This is going to make sense. So first, we're going to define some arguments to the CN function over here. So we're going to do dot, 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 and then inputs like this. These are going to be all of the potential class name inputs that this function can receive, and we can have any arbitrary amount of them. We don't care how many there are. These inputs are directly going to be sent to CLSX, so we don't even have to manage them manually ourselves. So what we're going to do is we're going to type these, and this is going to be class value from CLSX, as you can see over here. We're going to make this an array of class value. If we go here to the definition of class value, this can either be a class array, so an array of classes of strings, or a class dictionary, so this is here a record with the classes as keys and then any value as the value of that class. Then it can also be a string, a number, null, boolean, undefined, anything that we want. This is CLSX, and it's going to use this to actually return everything that you pass into one single string that we can use as the class name property. So then we're going to take this string, we're going to take all of these inputs here, and we're going to return, and we're going to do TW merge. This is the function from Tailwind merge, which is just going to merge a string of classes, of Tailwind utility classes, and make sure that there's no duplicates, and make sure that we can safely use that on the class name property. And then we're just going to pass this, we're going to do CLSX, we're going to import this from CLSX, and we're going to pass the inputs that we received over here. So we're not directly doing anything with the inputs, we're just passing the inputs to CLSX, and then we're passing the result of that to Tailwind merge and returning that as the return value of this CN function over here. Now, if you're a little bit confused as to how this all works, that's totally fine, I understand. You can go and look at the documentation of CLSX, see how that works, and then look at Tailwind merge and see how that works as well. It's pretty simple, and if you just look at it a little bit, you'll get it, don't worry about it. And then, now that we have this function here, all that we have to do is come back here to our button and just use it. So we can actually remove all of this button variants here. And actually, let me just make sure that I copy this correctly. We could just remove this and then wrap everything in CN. So we can do CN and then import this from utils slash CN. And then we're going to call this and we're going to put here the first input, this button variant, which is going to be a string. And as the second input, we're going to pass class name like so. These are the actual inputs to the CN function that we defined here. So button variant with this is going to be a string that is going to be the first input. Class name is going to be a string that is going to be the second input. This is going to come here and is going to resolve and merge this with Tailwind merge. And that is going to return to us one single class name string that we're passing to the button class name. So now if we open up the application, the button looks exactly as we had it before. But now we can come here and we can go to app and we can provide any class name that we want. So we can do class name and we can do, for example, background red 500 and set a background color that is going to override the background color of the variant of type secondary. Now, if we open up the application, our button has a background color of red, which is exactly what we specified. And this is a great way to build really extensible and really composable components that you can use across your entire application. And this is exactly what Shadcn does with all of their components. This is literally the same thing that we did here. The only difference is that in Shadcn, they usually have a lot more classes and it's a little bit more overwhelming to read and understand. But this is really simple. And again, it's exactly the same thing that Shadcn does. And we're using the same libraries in the same way and producing the same output, just in a simpler way that is easier, perhaps for a beginner, to understand and to work with. So if you're interested to learn more about this and see how Shadcn works, you can go to their website, ui.shadcn.com, and see how they build their components and actually integrate them in your own applications. And if you want to see more examples of components just like these, I would strongly recommend that you check out my upcoming React course, Project React. You can find it at coslin.solutions/Project React, or it's going to be the first link in the description. As I said in the beginning of this video, all of the UI components that I built in this project in Project React all followed the same exact thing that we did in this video. So these are a great example if you're trying to learn React. And this course is going to teach you literally everything that you need to know to be able to build a real-world big and complex application with React. You will be guided step by step, every single step of the way with code and videos. And by the end of it, you'll be able to confidently, meaningfully contribute to any React project that you work on. So again, coslin.solutions/Project React, or click the first link in the description. You will not regret it. There is no other course like it, I promise you. If you enjoyed this video and you want to see more videos just like this one, make sure to leave this video a big thumbs up. You can also click here to subscribe, or you can click here to watch a different video of mine that YouTube seems to think that you're really going to enjoy. And with that being said, my name has been Darius Coslin. This is Coslin Solutions. Thank you so much for watching, and I will see you in the next video. Ciao, ciao.